Hi, and welcome to another episode of Storybook Railroad, brought to you by the world of RobinAndTheGiant.com.
Robin, I love Battery Park. I can see so far. It's a beautiful day. Look at the Statue of Liberty. It looks like you can almost reach it. It's so clear today.
Oh, yeah. Doesn't this give you chills, all this history that's surrounding us?
I know. Isn't it weird it's called Battery Park?
Mm-hmm.
They don't use any batteries down here.
Yeah, but it's so historical. I just love it here.
I went one Thanksgiving to the Franz's restaurant. That's where George Ooh. Washington retired.
Oh, my gosh. Isn't that exciting?
All these streets here in the lower part of the city, mm-hmm. they're all exactly the same layout as back in the early days of the 1700s.
And I read something about Wall Street, that it really wasn't a street. It just used to be a wall, and then there was nothing behind there.
Whoa, a lot has changed. Huh, Billy? Yeah, Billy was here back then. Well, not Billy, but his ancestors.
Oh, yeah, Billy has a lot of history, too, being a pigeon.
Yeah, pigeons came here in the 1600s.
Isn't that fascinating?
Well, who knew? Billy, you're an immigrant.
Yeah.
You're a child of an immigrant. We've got a lot of memories, huh, Robin?
Oh, yeah, we most certainly do. I just think this is fabulous.
You wrote a story called Memories, and I mm-hmm. was thinking, as long as we're sitting here on this beautiful day on this park bench, looking out over the water and Lady Liberty out there, why don't we read your story called Memories?
Okay, let's do that.
By Robin MacBlane.
Okay.
A.K.A. Robin.
Christopher, Elaine, Matthew, and Carl were all sitting around Matthew's circular kitchen table. In front of each of them was lined writing paper, a pencil, and an open school history book. They were reviewing what they had learned during the school year and were trying to decide on what topic to choose for their fifth grade history project.
Their teacher, Mrs. Evans, had divided the class into seven groups of four students each. Instead of giving them a final written exam at the end of the year, she told them this project would be that exam. Each group was required to select any historical event they wanted and present it to the class while pretending they were the teacher. "This is really tough," Carl said exhaustingly, pushing back his chair and stretching his legs out in front of him.
"I didn't realize just how much stuff we talked about this year," yawned Christopher as he punched the point of his pencil through the middle of a sheet of lined writing paper. Using his fingers, he then twirled the pencil in his right hand in front of him, making the paper spin around in circles. "That's because you are always sleeping," said Elaine with a chuckle, as she lightly tapped him on his left shoulder with her right hand. All four children laughed. "Say," said Matthew, "all this deciding is making me hungry. Let's take a break and eat those sandwiches my mom made and left for us in the refrigerator. We also have milk to drink."
"Great idea," exclaimed Carl as he jumped out of his chair before Matthew was able to get up out of his. "I'll help. You get the milk and I'll get the sandwiches," Carl said, looking backwards over his right shoulder at his friends as he walked toward the refrigerator. "Oof," said Carl as he was stopped abruptly. "Whoa, young fellow," he heard a deep voice say. "You have to watch where you're going or you'll get hurt."
Carl looked up and saw the face behind the voice. It was Matthew's grandfather, and Carl had walked right into him.
"Sorry, sir," said Carl apologetically. "I was so interested in getting those sandwiches that I wasn't paying any attention to where I was walking. Are you all right?"
"I'm fine. In fact, that's what I was coming in here for, to get something to eat," said Matthew's grandfather as he smiled at all four children. "Mind if I join you?"
Not at all, the four children said cheerily in unison. Matthew and Carl went to the refrigerator and got the sandwiches and milk. Matthew's grandfather went to the cupboard and got glasses, plates, and napkins for each of them. Elaine and Christopher cleared all the books, papers, and pencils off of the kitchen table and set them on the table in the hall. Matthew, Carl, and Matthew's grandfather set their items on the table. Christopher brought another kitchen chair from the far wall and put it at the table for Matthew's grandfather. They all then sat down at the table and began eating their lunch.
"Matthew?" asked Matthew's grandfather inquisitively while he
put a sandwich on his plate. "Why are you and your friends inside on a Saturday? It's such a beautiful sunny day. I would think you would rather be enjoying the outdoors."
"We're doing a project for our history class," Matthew responded. "Mrs. Evans, our teacher, wants us to do a report on a historical event for our final exam. We're trying to decide on what topic to choose." "And boy, is it ever tough to decide," Christopher interjected as he took a swallow of his milk. "Too bad the people that created the historical events aren't still around. It would be more fun to talk to them about the facts than to look them up in books," said Matthew as he ate the last bite of his sandwich.
Matthew's grandfather finished his sandwich and milk. He looked at Matthew with a grin. "Matthew," Matthew's grandfather said with growing excitement in his voice, "I'd like to take you and your friends someplace where you can all witness history in the making. Come on, let's clear off the table, put the stuff away, and then follow me."
Everyone helped. They cleared off the table and put the food away. They rinsed off the dishes and put them in the sink. The four children then followed Matthew's grandfather out of the kitchen, down towards the end of the hall, and then up the stairs into the attic.
Matthew's grandfather entered the dark attic first. He turned on the lights so the children would be able to see.
"Hey," whispered Christopher to Matthew, "I thought your grandfather said he was taking us to a place where we could see history in the making. What are we doing in your attic?"
"This is not just an attic, my boy," replied Matthew's grandfather as he gave Christopher a knowing smile and a wink.
Christopher's face grew red with embarrassment.
Matthew's grandfather walked toward a large old trunk in the east corner of the attic. He knelt down in front of the trunk. He motioned for the four children to gather around him. Matthew and Christopher stood on his left side, and Elaine and Carl stood on his right side.
"What's inside, sir?" asked Elaine curiously as she peeked over Matthew's grandfather's right shoulder as he touched the top of the old trunk lightly with both his hands.
Matthew's grandfather looked up at Elaine with a sparkle in his eyes and replied proudly, "Inside, my dear young lady, is history in the making." Matthew's grandfather then held onto the lid of the trunk with both hands and pushed it open for the children to see. They all looked inside.
"Papers!" Carl exclaimed with disappointment. "All that's in this trunk are stacks of papers."
"Ah," said Matthew's grandfather to all four children with patience in his voice, "these are not just any papers. They are the documentation of the history that I have witnessed during my lifetime. Go ahead, take a stack and look for yourself," Matthew's grandfather said with an inviting tone in his voice. He then selected his own stack of papers and sat cross-legged on the attic floor, a short distance away from the open trunk.
The children looked at one another with confusion in their minds, but they did as he asked. They each selected a stack of papers and sat on the floor in a circle around Matthew's grandfather.
"Wow, look at this!" exclaimed Carl as he held one of the papers high in the air for all to see.
"What is it, Carl?" asked Elaine as all the children and Matthew's grandfather looked up at the paper.
"This is a picture of Babe Ruth in 1927 after he hit his 60th home run, taped to the newspaper article about him," said Carl excitedly. "And there's something written on it. It says, 'To Nathan, thank you for being my loyal fan.' And it's signed, George Herman Ruth, the Babe."
Carl looked at Matthew's grandfather and saw him smiling.
"How did you get this picture, sir?" asked Carl to Matthew's grandfather.
"I was there, at that game, watching it with my father. Together, we saw him hit that home run," replied Matthew's grandfather, tears welling up in his eyes. "My father and I went to the newspaper reporter that did the story, and he gave us the Babe's picture. We went to the field where the Babe practiced, and he signed it for me. My first name is Nathan."
"Cool,"
said all four children in unison. Carl carefully laid the Babe's picture by his side, and all four children went back to looking through their stacks. Suddenly, Christopher shouted loudly, "Look what I found! A newspaper article about Neil Armstrong being the first man to set foot on the moon on July 20th, 1969. This article even tells about the space program and gives a hint about using space shuttles someday. "Sir," Elaine said to Matthew's grandfather, interrupting Christopher, "can you tell me about this picture?" Elaine handed the picture to Matthew's grandfather.
He studied it for a moment and then gave the picture back to Elaine. "This is one of the wedding pictures of a beautiful American movie star who married a handsome prince," Matthew's grandfather answered. "Her name is Grace Kelly, and his name is Prince Rainier of Monaco. She gave up her successful acting career to become his princess. She had lived her life helping others unselfishly."
"Oh, man," said Matthew to his grandfather, showing everyone the picture he held. "You never told me you got an autographed picture of the Beatles. I just thought you liked that big band music."
Matthew's grandfather laughed. "I do like big band music," Matthew's grandfather answered lightly. "But I also was intrigued by those four young men from Liverpool, England. So much so that I wanted to hear for myself the group that was changing and influencing the musical styles of the world. I was able to get tickets to one of their concerts. Your grandmother went with me, and we were lucky enough to get that autographed picture after the concert. Don't tell your mother, but she thinks your grandmother and I only liked big band music." Matthew's grandfather laughed, and so did all four children.
"Sir," asked Elaine, "do you think we can use some of your papers for our class project? We'd be very careful with them."
"I don't see why not," replied Matthew's grandfather warmly. "You know, I'll bet all of your grandparents have some exciting papers and memories of their own that they would love to share with you," said Matthew's grandfather as he looked lovingly at Matthew. "They're probably just waiting for you to ask them."
Matthew got up, walked over to his grandfather, and gave him a big hug. "I love you, grandfather," Matthew said. "Will you share some more memories with us?"
"You bet," Matthew's grandfather exclaimed excitedly.
Christopher, Matthew, Elaine, Carl, and Matthew's grandfather stayed in the attic the rest of the day.
The end.
Ooh, that gives me chills, that story.
That is something, Robin. You know, we have history all around us, and sometimes we don't even know that some of the people who are older than us could just talk to us about that history. We could learn so much just by listening to older people.
Oh, yeah, and I think Matthew's grandfather is really, really right. I think that sometimes your grandparents are just waiting for you to ask them a question.
Hey, Billy, you know, you got some relatives here, too, somewhere. There must be some old birds around here. You ever go to any of the old birds and ask them about your history? I bet you come from a long line of like carrier pigeons or messenger pigeons or something like that.
Oh, I'll bet you're right. And look at Billy. He's kind of looking around now. And, oh, there he goes. I think he found a relative.
Robin, I want to go up to Wall Street. I want to see where that wall used to be.
Okay, me too.
Let's go, Billy.